want to express my gratitude for being invited to be a part of this conversation this afternoon. Give a special thanks, as always, and an honor to share the stage platform of my dear brother Wade Henderson, someone who's been involved in this struggle for social justice for many, 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 many years. From the time I was a young man, he's been involved in this struggle.
I think I was a cop. I sure.
Of course. My task this afternoon is to talk a little bit about the process. I'm not going to get into the issues that were raised during the UPR process, but to talk about the process that we engaged in with the government before and leading up to the actual evaluation that took place in November. As Wade thoroughly laid out, the UPR process is a relatively new process, a process that was born with the creation of the new Human Rights Council, a process that was geared to try to, in their effort to depoliticize the human rights issue and the examination of states around the world. And the process was very simple. It said basically that every state on the planet would have its human rights record examined once every 4 years. Makes sense. What was important about that was not only the fact that they would be examined, but that their record would be looked at not just in terms of the treaties that they may have signed and ratified, but that the entire human rights framework would serve as the framework for analysis. And that's very, very important, because it meant for us as activists here in this country that we can raise critical issues around issues related to economic, social, and cultural rights. A whole body of international human rights law that our lawmakers and representatives have had recognized up until this point as being a legitimate component of the human rights framework. So that process is very important. It allows us to amplify a number of issues that go beyond just the treaties. Wade mentioned the fact that the government involved in a process of consultative meetings, very important. That's one of the recommendations, one of the innovations related to the UPR process, that theoretically states are supposed to engage civil society in the creation of their reports before they are in fact examined. And the U.S. did that. We have to, as Wade said, acknowledge that. But there were some issues, of course. In the beginning, when we first sat down with members of the State Department, they called the series of consultations road trip. Basically, they were going to go from city to city and just listen to the activists. It had more of a feel I wouldn't say propaganda event, but it had more of a feel of a theatrical sort of activity as opposed to a real consultative process. But as soon as the first one occurred in New Orleans, it was very clear that that thinking had to change, because the activists took this very, very seriously. And they came out in large numbers in New Orleans. And to the government's credit, they had a panel of about 15 individuals representing various agencies. And I think all of them were struck by the level of detail that these activists brought to the table. They were struck by the passion that folks had in New Orleans. They were struck by the fact that many of these activists had been grounded in human rights language in the framework, and were utilizing that framework and that language in their interaction with government officials. So the activists took this very, very seriously, and they wanted a real consultative process. And I think that at that point, I think there was a rethinking. And the subsequent consultative meetings became more substantive. There was more time to plan them correctly, and that took place from across the country. I already have 1 minute. I'm going to get past my second point. Let me go quickly then. Basically, we had a process that's very important in terms of its consultative character. Civil society organized itself. The U.S. Human Rights Network was honored to be part of that process, helping to organize and galvanize civil society. Through that process, we submitted something like 24 reports, joint reports to the UN High Commission. As a consequence of those reports, we saw that when the Office of the UN High Commission on Human Rights, once they compiled their report that then goes to all of the state delegates, they cited the US HR reports more than 60 times. So we had a basic impact on that process. When we went to Geneva in November, the government sent something like 34 individuals to represent the government side. Civil society showed up in force also. We had something like 80 individuals who were there in Geneva to have a physical presence and to make sure that our voices were in fact heard during that process. It was a very interesting process for the government. They received more than 228 recommendations, the most recommendations of any government up until this point. Of those recommendations, they accepted something like 40-something. I can't remember the exact number, but they accepted 40-something recommendations. After that evaluation in November, we had a town hall meeting with the government, very historic. Not only for us in terms of civil society, but in terms of the kind of model that should have and can have for this process around the world. And we clearly acknowledge the government for that. We've been pushing other members of civil society from other parts of the world to push their governments to engage in a similar kind of process. What's important now, my friends, after the reports have been done, the meetings have taken place, we had a series of high-level meetings with the White House between November and when they actually adopted the report 2 Fridays ago. What's important now is follow-up. And the follow-up means that now that the U.S. is required to engage in a process of submitting reports to the treaties that they are a part of, that is the CERD, International Convention to Eliminate All Forms of Racial Discrimination, ICCPR, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, and CAT, the Convention Against Torture. The U.S. has to submit their state reports. Now we need to make sure that the recommendations that the U.S. did adopt, that they find themselves as part of that discussion, and that we are able to amplify those recommendations to make sure we have an integrated process for addressing many of the issues that we all are concerned about. I'm going to take my seat, but the last thing to point out is that there was agreement on some of the very basic institutional reforms that were necessary to signal to the world and to us in civil society that the government was serious about human rights compliance. And that is to push for an interagency working group on the federal level. It was the push to create a national human rights structure that would coordinate and educate all of the levels of government and civil society on its U.S. human rights obligations, and the commitment to expand its treaty obligations, its treaty ratification process. Those are some of the structural and institutional reforms we thought were important, we agreed on, and we intend to continue to push on. But it's going to take all of us working together, working with members of the legislature, working with members in the executive branch, to push the state, push the government to live up to its obligations and to make its commitment to human rights more than just rhetoric, but something that's really real. Thank you.